Hey everyone, just remember this is one of a six-part video series with Seth Muncy at Disc Golf Strong. Check out the description to links to the other five. Hey everyone, I'm Scott Stokely and I'm here with Seth Muncy with Disc Golf Strong, and this is day six of our training. It's been an amazing week. I came all the way to Las Vegas for phase four of my training camp preparing for the 2022 season. I could not have made a better decision for my career at this point. This is the best, there's no words. I'm like literally at a loss for words for the first time in my life at just how overwhelmingly awesome it's been to work with you, Seth. We're gonna talk about the final part of this series, which is recovery. And if you're watching this and you didn't read the title, don't click away now thinking, well, this is not that important, or nah, you know, I'm 23 years old, recovery's not that important. I have learned that it's epically important. There's science behind why it's important. It's not about resting. I don't rest. I don't slow down. I don't want to rest. Your body needs to, and it functions better in the future when that happens. Baseball pitchers don't pitch every single day. Mm-hmm. If they did, you would have one pitcher, you'd pay him 50% more, the team would save a bundle, and you'd never lose if you had insert top baseball pitcher. I don't follow baseball anymore. Mm-hmm. Recovery is everything, right?
Yeah, it is. And thanks again, Scott, for coming out here. It's been a true amazing honor and pleasure working with you this week. Recovery is incredibly important. And you know, the thing with disc golf that I'm not going to say it's completely unique, because there's probably other sports out there where they're doing it as much as we do. But I always say that the great thing about disc golf is you can play every day. And the worst thing about disc golf is we can play every day, you know, even if we shouldn't. Because honestly, like, though I get so many messages from disc golfers around the world, really, not just here, but I get it from you know, Europe and other places where they said, hey, Seth, you know, I started playing 6 months ago. I started playing a year and a half ago or whatever. And, you know, I've been playing 5, 6, 7 days a week, and now I can't pour a cup of coffee. I can't play with my kids. You know, my shoulder feels like it's going to fall off. You know, my hip is hurting, right? Well, they're playing every single day. And like Scott said, you know, I use baseball analogies all the time. And a starting pitcher, throws once every 5 days. It's a 5-day rotation on average for them. So they throw and then they rest. They have to rest because they're letting everything rejuvenate and recover, and they do active recovery. Kind of what you were hitting on earlier when you mentioned, you know, like, not just not doing anything. You want to do active recovery. There's passive recovery, and passive recovery is just like, okay, I'm just going to not do anything. And that doesn't mean you sit on a couch, but I'm just not going to do anything active. I'm not going to throw. Okay, I'm not going to throw. That's a passive recovery. Active recovery is I'm going to actually do things to try to accelerate and optimize my recovery. And like you said, you don't have, you know, you may be 23 and going, but I don't need to do it. You know who's 23 and doing active recovery? Like baseball pitchers that are making, you know, $40 million and they're 23 years old and they're doing active recovery. NHL players that are 19 years old are making millions. Yeah, go ahead.
This is why I'm here, because my intention was passive recovery, which was I'm taking a break every 3 days, and you're saying that I could actually be doing things for my training, my overall training picture, on those days.
Mm-hmm.
So yep. I'm all ears.
Yeah, you want to do active measures, okay, to recover. And so we talk about this in week six of our Disc Golf Strong Performance Academy, which is the recovered disc golf athlete, because the more recovered athlete is going to be the more resilient athlete, the more powerful athlete. When things start going into endurance, you're playing multiple rounds, you're playing multiple days in a row, right? You show up the next day and one athlete is just beat down, they don't feel recovered at all. They're not going to be able to perform at the same level as the athlete that did active recovery measures and that has optimized those recovery measures. So they show up feeling more refreshed. They show up being able to actually tap into that potential that they have. Okay. So now when we talk about active recovery, there are hundreds and probably more than that ways that you can do work on your active recovery, all right? And so as I have in our academy, it narrows it down to just a few. Because I get people, they say, hey, should I do, you know, hot and cold contrast showers? Should I do compression therapy? Should I do blood flow restriction? Should I, you know, do ice cold water immersion? Should I, you know, acupuncture? And there's so many different things that you could do that could fall under active recovery. One of my mentors in the strength world, he always tells this little joke. He says, you know, someone walks up to his doc, you know, goes in to see his doctor, and he's, you know, smoking a cigarette and he's drinking some whiskey, and he says, doc, hey, I want to really improve my health. What should I do? I'm thinking about putting chia seeds in some oatmeal. Do you think I should put chia seeds in my oatmeal? Will that make me healthier? And the doc says, how about we work on the cigarettes and the drinking first, right? So right. So we want to keep it simple before we start going out and hitting all these other things. So what's the simple things that we can do? Now, they could be defined as passive recovery, like sleep, like hydration, right? Those are two things, and nutrition. Those are really three things that could be considered passive, but what makes them active is we're actually going to work on them. We're not just going to sleep. Like, you want to work on improving and optimizing your sleep. Most people have a sleep debt. They're not sleeping the way that they should, and so they're like, well, I see some faces over here. So, you know, you can take these passive, what seem like passive recovery measures, sleep, hydration, nutrition, right? Just things that we're gonna normally do, but you actually become active recovery measures because you're trying to actively optimize them, right? And so again, like that joke, the chia seeds, you know, do I put those in my oatmeal? Is that gonna make me healthier as I'm smoking and drinking all day, every day? No, worry about that. Like, don't worry about those other big things, right? Like a chia seeds or this and that. Worry first about what is actually happening in your life, like sleep, like nutrition, like your hydration, okay? Most of us operate in a sleep debt. Most people, humans, operate in a sleep debt. We don't sleep well. And even if we don't sleep a lot of hours in, right? Even if we don't sleep a lot of hours, we can still do things to optimize the hours that we are sleeping. So we can use things like, there's apps that I talk about, like in our academy, where there's free apps even that you can download on your phone. They work. You put them up next to you while you sleep at night. It listens to your breathing. It listens to your movement. And then tells you in the morning how restless you were, right? Were you snoring? Things like that. And then you can look and go, okay, you know, am I drinking enough water? Am I doing enough, you know, am I getting in bed early enough? Am I stopping looking at electronics at night? Am I using blue light blocking glasses maybe when I'm looking at electronics at night? To help kind of stop the brain having to get all that, the eyes to absorb all that blue light to make you think, make the brain think it's, you know, 1 p.m. when it's really, you know, 10 p.m., 11 p.m.
Yeah. By the way, I will go ahead and after we're done here, I'll get a list of some of those and I'll put links to all these apps and things. So anything mm-hmm. we're talking about, check the description and I'll tell you how to get them for free if possible.
Mm-hmm. Yep, sounds good. Okay, and so we work on optimizing your sleep, okay? So that's the big thing, is first focus on that, okay? Do you have to eliminate distractions, all that kind of stuff. And then making sure that you're drinking enough water, you're hydrating well enough, okay? And then also trying to optimize your nutrition some. Get, you know, if you need to work on getting enough protein, you need to work on getting enough, you know, the vegetables and things like that, and good fats, right? So those are going to be those building blocks of recovery that you can start working on right away. Now again, hot, cold contrast showers, all that, you can, you know, there's a lot of research that's being done on all those kind of things that you can look into, but those are the areas that you start. All right, now there's also some things that we do with part of our recovery is working on our breath work. That's another thing that is passive, but it's active. Working on breath work, okay, doing things like 4-7-8 breathing, 4 second in, 7 second hold, 8 second out, put us in more in a physiological, like, rest and digest state, that kind of jump starts a recovery process. We can do that before we go to bed at night or as we're laying in bed to help kind of get ourselves moving towards a more restful sleep. Okay, we can work on doing soft tissue work. So having a foam roller or having something like we on tour, I use like this is Rad, R-A-D, Rad Roller. Okay, I use all their, we use all of their products on tour. They're amazing. So a foam roller. So doing some soft tissue work, you know, for your upper back, your back muscles here, your legs. This is also from Rad, where it's just these little things where I can, you know, get in and use to work on the muscles of soft tissue work. And then I love this kind of thing to have in your bag. So when you're out on the course, you can take this and you can just roll. And you can roll out your quads, you can roll out something. So this is what you can use, and you can find other products. These are just the ones that I'm using, but you can find foam rollers and other things out there, and balls and stuff to use to work on improving your soft tissue, you know, the soft tissue that you have of breaking up and pushing through any sort of, you know, like increasing blood flow and stuff like that, you know, push through like lactic acid, things like that. So those are some areas that you want to work on in your recovery. Last really big point I want to hit on is that when you are, if you're throwing all the time and you're not keeping, you don't really keep track of your pitch count, we say, but if you're doing a lot of reps all the time and you're hurting, it's probably time to take a break from that movement, okay? Yeah. Another, I love jokes like this, like we have another joke where guy walks into his doctor and he's hitting his thumb with a hammer and he says, "Doc, I gotta tell you, my thumb is killing me. You know, you think we should go cortisone injection? Should I take some aspirin? What should I do?" And the doc says, "Well, stop hitting your thumb with a hammer. That's step one." Okay, so if you're doing something and you're throwing sidearm and your elbow just feels like trash, like take a break from that. Doesn't mean you have to stop playing disc golf. Do other things, work on optimizing other areas, where take that as a way to say, hey, you know what, this is a great opportunity for me to work on things that maybe I avoided because forehand, like sidearm was my thing, but now this is a great opportunity of growth to allow me to work on those other areas and just build that tool chest, right? Build that, put more tools in your belt, and use that opportunity, use that time to do that.
I love this, and this is one of the rare areas that's actually crossed over into some of my area of expertise. I've taught more people disc golf than anyone in the sport, and I have never, not one single time, seen a player doing something that's hurting that pushed through it and the pain went away. I've never seen that.
Yep.
It's always worse when you keep doing the thing that's hurting you.
Yep.
And it goes against probably some old military and it definitely goes against the 70s coaching I got when you know it was about push through stuff. That is so antiquated.
You know, I want to say this. So like, I had the good fortune a while not too long ago to I was doing a wilderness first responder like medical course, and it was like a week long, like 10-hour days, and I had the honor and pleasure to be partnered with this gentleman who was the former commander of SEAL Team 6. Like SEAL Team 6 is the team that got, like went and got Osama bin Laden. Like they are the top, okay? And he also did a bunch of other crazy stuff that SEALs do. They do not work at that high of a level of intensity all the time, right? They push themselves in when they need to, but that's not how they operate. Because could you imagine, like, the top operators go out and they're trying to perform and they're like, "Man, my shoulder's all banged up from that crazy workout I did," or, "Man, my legs are so sore, I can't do anything for a week." And it's like, no, well, you got to be, you know, on the other side of the world in 10 hours. And it's like, oh, man, like they don't push themselves at that level all the time. Intensity does not equal effectiveness. Okay, you have to, and neither does effort. Effort and intensity don't equal effectiveness. So if you're pushing yourself all the time, you're going to work a lot less. Like you're going to operate at a greater level of like chronic stress and not be prepared to go out there and make it, you know, happen when it counts. Like I said in an earlier video, you know, the risk versus reward. If when I was working in hockey, we crushed the athletes in the gym, and then the coach is like, the manager's like, all right, boys, let's get on the ice. And they're like, I can't even get down and like,
right.
I can't put my skates on right now because coach just crushed me in the weight room. How is that? Why is that good for me and my coach, you know, my boss there? How would that look on us if we're crushing the athletes? Because that's not where the show is. The show's on the ice. The show's on the course.
I love how aligned we are with everything. I mean, I teach that in disc golf throwing technique. Like when you're playing a round of disc golf, the only times you're putting out effort, you're not even putting effort on the entire run up. The effort does not start until right there, mm-hmm. and it lasts like an eighth of a second. Mm-hmm. You can't put effort into all the other parts without damaging your ability to that eighth of a second. So you're saying it's the same thing with the training and recovery too. Mm-hmm. It's about bursts of effort.
Yes.
And then take it down.
Yes. Perfect. Passive recovery. Make sure that you're ready to perform when it counts. When it counts.
Yeah, I love it. All right. So we could talk for hours and hours on this, and your course goes into much detail on this, but this is why you need to sign up for the Disc Golf Strong Academy. Just follow Seth, everything he's doing, everything new that comes out that he's going to be adding. I'm aware of some of the things you're planning on doing that are really exciting. I'm on board and I endorse him 100%. So if you believe anything I've ever taught you as far as throwing sidearms and backhands and putting, and you're a better disc golfer, take my word for it. This is the real deal. No question. Thank you so much.
Thank you for
your week. Mm-hmm. Now I'm excited because I've actually not been throwing other than a couple like warm-up rounds to see how I feel in the last week or two. Because I've been getting my body in position to start the throwing portion of my training camp, which is going to be 3 months of intense. It's a training camp. I'm trying to be the best in the world at something, but it'll be intense throwing portion with all of the Disc Golf Strong, all the cross training, all the nutrition, everything else I'm doing. But I get to start throwing next week. I've been waiting for 3 months to start throwing. It's been crazy, like, to put that on hold, but it was the right decision. I'm sure it was.
I'm going to hit on that real quick. I know we're wrapping up here.
Yeah, please.
But, you know, a baseball pitcher in the major leagues, when the season is over, they have a period that they're not throwing. Like, they're not throwing year-round. Like, if I walk up to a major league baseball pitcher and I said, here's a bucket of 100 balls, I want you to throw this multiple times a day, all year round, they'd be like, no, like, you know, this is not going to be good for me. And they need to have that period of recovery so that the muscles and everything can kind of, you know, not say settle, but they get that rejuvenation, that restoration period. So, you know, use some of that. It's hard as a disc golfer to tell disc golfers to not play disc golf, right? But that's my role as a coach. Like, that's my role as a coach.
It's true,
sit there and say, you know, hey, let's not do that right now, right? The role of a coach in baseball or football is to come, or any sport, is to come on and say, hey, let's go off the mound. We can bring in someone else in. We need you fresh for the next time, right? So even though that player says, I can stay out there. I know you can, right? But this is not about this moment. This is about you wanting to play disc golf as long as you can. Right, as long as you can. And so if you need to take a little bit of time of rest and recovery, do that. It's not a bad thing. You're not going to be a worse player if you have a small period of time, a small window of time where you know, work on other things.
Yeah, I'll even add to that, because after taking the long break, I just started a week and a half ago easing back into throwing, just playing a casual round of golf, 18 throws on a short course. And I talked to Ricky and asked him if he wanted to golf with me. And he said, oh, I'm not starting throwing for 3 more weeks. But it was a very intentional thing. And he will almost certainly, I don't want to speak for Ricky, but he'll be easing back into it about the same way I was easing into it. Mm-hmm. So I just started my easing into throwing a few weeks early. But when he said that, it was I didn't question it. It's like, okay, yeah. Your training schedule starts in 3 weeks. Mine started a week and a half ago. That's all it was, timing.
Yeah.
Same plan, though.
Yeah, yeah. You work into it. You know, again, I use professional baseball all the time, but, you know, we're throwing, pitchers are throwing, right? They don't show up to training camp, and they're like, all right, let's see your best stuff.
No.
Get out there.
And, right? and I know, I mean, I've,
yeah,
I've,
you know,
I've spent enough time with Ricky. He could throw for 10 hours a day, yeah. 365 days a year,
yeah.
and still be very, very, yeah. very good. But he's better doing it his way.
Exactly.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Be sure to click like and subscribe. Make sure you follow Seth. I already said this 18 seconds ago, but do it. Subscribe to his YouTube channel. Follow him on Instagram and Facebook and all the other social media the kids are using that we've never heard of.
yep.
But follow him on everything, and you will not regret it. Thanks, you guys. Seth, again, thank you so much.
Yep.
Ready to go out to dinner?
Let's do it.
Let's
again,
do it.
Train disc golf strong so you can play disc golf strong.